Hello, I am Grandmother Fa, here to tell you the story of my brave granddaughter, Fa Mulan. It all began the day Mulan was to meet the matchmaker. If Mulan made a good match, that is, found a good husband, she would bring great honor to our family. But Mulan was no ordinary girl. You'll be surprised to find out how she brought honor to us. All you have to do is follow along with me in your book, and be sure to turn the page when you hear this sound. The big day had arrived. While Mulan was finishing her chores at home, her mother and I were waiting for her in the village. Mulan's mother, Fa Li, was a nervous wreck.
Of all days to be late, I should have prayed to the ancestors for luck.
Finally, Mulan came galloping up on her horse, calm. There were twigs in her hair, and she was dusty from her ride.
I'm here.
What?
But Mama, I had to...
None of your excuses. Now let's get you cleaned up.
This is what you give me to work with. Well, honey, I've seen worse. We're gonna turn this sow's ear into a silk purse.
Oh, it's freezing.
It would have been warm if you were here on time.
We'll have you washed and dried, trimmed and polished till you glow with pride. Trust my recipe for instant bride. You'll bring honor to us all.
Mulan, what's this?
Notes, in case I forget something.
Hold this. You'll need more luck than I thought.
Wait and see when we're through. Boys will gladly go to war for you. With good fortune and a great hairdo, you'll bring honor to us all.
Our will can bring the family great honor in one way, by striking a good match, and this could be the day.
Men want girls with good taste,
calm, obedient,
who work fast-paced,
with good breeding and a tiny waist.
You'll bring honor to us all. We all must serve our emperor, who hides us from the Huns. A man by bearing arms, a girl by bearing sons.
When we're through, you can't fail. Like can just blossoms, like can fail. Like what any fellow sail to sail. How bring honor to us, sail to sail.
For balance,
beads of jade for beauty. You must proudly show it. Now add a cricket just for luck, and even you can't blow it. Ancestors, hear my plea. Help me not to make a fool of me, and to not uproot my family. Keep my father standing tall.
Scarier than the Undertaker, we are needing our matchmaker. Yes, baby, guard our girls, and our future as fast young girls. Please look kindly on these sponsored girls, each a perfect porcelain doll. Please bring honor to us, please bring honor to us, please bring honor to us, please bring honor to us.
As soon as the matchmaker saw Mulan, she began listing all the things she didn't like.
Speaking without permission? Too skinny. Not good for bearing sons.
The meeting was a disaster. Cricky, Mulan's lucky cricket, jumped into the matchmaker's teacup. Mulan spilled tea on the matchmaker, and the matchmaker's dress caught on fire. when she fell onto a hot stove.
You are a disgrace! You may look like a bride, but you will never bring your family honor!
Fa Li and I tried to comfort Mulan, but we could hear the villagers talking.
Her poor family. What a shame.
Sadly, Mulan led Khan home, ashamed to face her father.
Look at me. I will never pass for a perfect bride or a perfect daughter. Can it be? I'm not meant to play this part. Now I see that if I were truly to be myself, I would break my family's heart. Oh, with that girl I see staring straight
Mulan's father, Fa Zhu, had seen Mulan enter the garden. He watched her sit beneath the blossoming magnolia tree and remove her hair comb. He could tell that the meeting with the matchmaker had not gone well. Fa Zhu sat beside his daughter and drew her attention to the tree above them.
My, my. What beautiful blossoms we have this year. Look, this one's late, but I'll bet that when it blooms, it will be the most beautiful of all.
He took Mulan's comb out of her hands and gently placed it in her hair. Just then, Chi Fu, the Emperor's aide, rode into the village.
Citizens, I bring a proclamation from the Imperial City. The Huns have invaded China!
The Huns?
By order of the Emperor, one man from every family must serve in the Imperial Army.
Mulan followed Fa Zhu into the street and ran up to Chi Fu. She was worried that her father was too old to fight.
Please, sir, my father has already fought bravely.
Silence! You would do well to teach your daughter to hold her tongue in a man's presence.
Mulan. You dishonor me.
That afternoon, Mulan secretly watched her father practice his sword moves. When the exercise caused him pain in the leg he'd hurt in a war, she could not bear to watch any longer. She hurried away, only to argue with him at dinner.
There are plenty of young men to fight for China.
It is an honor to protect my country and my family.
So you'll die for honor?
I will die doing what's right.
But if you...
I know my place. It is time you learned yours.
That night, I dreamed the ancestors were trying to tell me something. I awoke with a start. Mulan is gone. I ran to tell her parents, and we saw that she had taken her father's conscription notice and left her hair comb in its place. Mulan had cut her beautiful hair, then changed into Faju's armor and galloped away on Khan. Anyone who saw Mulan would think that she was a son, not a daughter. The courtyard gate was open. Fali clutched Faju's arm.
You must go after her. She could be killed.
If I reveal her, she will be.
Faju knew the law. If a woman pretended to be a man, the penalty was death. I turned to the family temple.
Ancestors, hear our prayer. Watch over Mulan.
The ancestors heard me. The first ancestor called for a disgraced little dragon named Mushu, who desperately wanted to be a family guardian again.
Tell me what mortal needs my protection, great ancestor. You just say the word and I'm there.
You are not worthy of this spot. Now, awaken the great stone dragon.
Mushu went outside and hit the statue with his gong. The great stone dragon crumbled into a million pieces. Now, Mushu was really in trouble. He decided to go after Mulan and make her a hero so he could get his place back as a guardian. Cricky followed along. Mulan didn't know what to make of the tiny dragon. The first thing Mushu did was start a fight between Mulan and the soldiers. The men happily blamed her when Captain Shang appeared.
I don't need anyone causing trouble in my camp. What's your name?
I've got a name. And it's a boy's name, too. Yes, my name is Ping.
Let me see your conscription notice.
Fazu, the Fazu?
Chi Fu, the Emperor's aide, looked suspicious.
I didn't know Fazu had a son.
He doesn't talk about me much.
Training was to begin right away, for the army needed many good soldiers. In order to teach the men both discipline and strength, Shang had them tie a bronze disc to each wrist and climb to the top of a tall pole to retrieve an arrow. Everyone failed, including Mulan. But my Mulan was determined and smart. One night, she tied the discs together and used them to pull herself up the pole. She was the first to get the arrow. After that, the other soldiers began to admire Mulan, especially the big Chen Po, the tall, skinny Ling, and the short, excitable Yao. They became her friends. Shang's troops felt inspired by Mulan. They worked harder to improve their skills. Soon, they would have to be ready to face Xuan Yu, the leader of the Huns, and his attacking army. Throughout all this, Mulan was pretending to be a man. But one night, she got tired of being dirty and smelly, so she sneaked off to a lake. As Mulan was bathing, her three friends came running down the hill, throwing off their clothes.
Oh, hi, guys. I didn't know you were here.
Mulan ducked behind a rock as Mushu dove underwater and bit Ling. Suddenly, Ling shot out of the water.
Snake!
While he and his pals hopped onto a rock, Mulan escaped. Mushu's trick had worked. When Mulan and Mushu returned to camp, they overheard Chi Fu talking to Shang.
Those boys are no more fit to be soldiers than you are to be captain. Once the general reads my report, your troops will never see battle.
Chi Fu was jealous of Shang. Angry, Shang walked away. Mulan called after him.
For what it's worth, I think you're a great captain.
Shang was happy to hear this, but Mushu was upset with Chi Fu.
I've worked too hard to get Mulan into this war. This guy's messing with my plan.
With Cricky's help, Mushu wrote a fake letter to Chi Fu from Shang's father, General Li. Chi Fu hurried to tell Shang the news.
Captain, urgent news from the general. We're needed at the front.
Of instead a girl worth fighting for. Huh? That's what I said, a girl worth fighting for. I wanna paler than the moon, with eyes that shine like stars.
A girl will marvel at my strength, adore my battle scar.
I couldn't care less what she'll wear or what she looks like. It all depends on what she cooks like.
Pork, chicken.
The local girl's going to quite the job.
And I'll bet the ladies love a man in armor.
You can guess what we have missed the most since we went off to war.
What do we want?
A girl worth fighting for.
During the march, the soldiers came to a village that had been burned down. Shang gazed around him.
Search for survivors.
At the scene of a fierce battle, Chen Po found General Li's helmet. The men watched Shang plant his sword in the snow, then place the helmet on it and reflect silently. They knew that Shan Yu had killed Shang's father. Mulan walked up to Shang to comfort him.
I'm sorry.
Shang put his hand on Mulan's shoulder. Then he mounted his horse.
The Huns are moving quickly. We'll make better time to the Imperial City through the Tungshao Pass. We're the only hope for the Emperor now. Move out!
At the Tungshao Pass, Mushu accidentally set off a rocket from the wagon that carried the weapons. Shang glared at Mulan.
What happened? You just gave away our position! Now we're... Oh.
Suddenly, a blizzard of arrows fell on Shang's men, launched by Shan Yu and the Huns. Shang yanked an arrow out of his armor.
Get out of range! Save the cannons!
Shang's men moved the cannons back and fired. Then Shang raised his hand.
Hold the last cannon!
As the smoke cleared, Shang and his men watched as a massive line of Huns appeared on the horizon.
Prepare to fight. If we die, we die with honor.
Shang turned to one of Mulan's friends.
Yeah, aim the cannon at Shan Yu.
Mulan looked down at her sword and saw the mountain reflected in the blade. She grabbed the cannon from Yao and began running toward the Huns.
Ping! Come back! Ping!
As Shan Yu galloped toward Mulan, Mushu's eyes grew bigger and bigger.
All right, you might want to light that right about now. Quickly, quickly!
Instead of firing at Shan Yu, Mulan tilted the cannon and fired at the mountaintop. The explosion started a huge avalanche. As a wall of snow thundered down toward the two armies, Shan Yu slashed angrily at Mulan. She ran away as the avalanche buried Shan Yu and his army. The snow kept spilling down the mountain. Mulan leaped on Khan and tried to grab Shang, but he disappeared under the snow. Soon after, she found him unconscious and lifted him onto Khan's back. High on a ridge, Yao tied a rope to an arrow and shot the arrow to Mulan. She grabbed it, but was still slipping backwards. Yao had dropped the rope. As Khan slid over the edge of a cliff, Mulan tied one end of the rope to her saddle and shot the other end back to her friends. Yao caught the rope and, with Chen Po's help, pulled Khan, Mulan, and Shang to safety. Shang woke.
Ping, you are the craziest man I've ever met. For that, I owe you my life. From now on, you have my trust.
Just then, Mulan fainted from the wound caused by Shan Yu's sword. The men carried her to the medic's tent. After the exam, the medic stepped outside the tent with startling news. Shi Fu went in and dragged Mulan out of the tent.
I knew there was something wrong with you.
A woman! Treacherous snake!
My name is Mulan. I did it to save my father.
High treason!
I didn't mean for it to go this far.
Ultimate dishonor!
Captain, you know the law.
Instead of killing Mulan, Shang did what he felt was right. He threw down her sword.
A life for a life. My debt is repaid.
The troops left Mulan and headed for the Imperial City.
I should never have left home. Maybe I didn't go for my father. Maybe what I really wanted was to prove I could do things right. So when I looked in the mirror, I'd see someone worthwhile. But I was wrong. I see nothing.
The truth is, we're both frauds. Your ancestors never sent me. They don't even like me. I mean, you risked your life to help people you love. I risked your life to help myself. At least you had good intentions.
Mulan heard a noise. She peeked over the ridge and saw Shan Yu and his toughest warriors climbing out of the snow and heading for the Imperial City. Mulan grabbed her sword and mounted Khan. In the Imperial City, Mulan caught up with Shang as he rode in the victory parade.
The Huns are alive. They're in the city.
You don't belong here, Mulan. Go home.
Mulan blocked his path.
You said you'd trust Ping. Why is Mulan any different?
Shang refused to listen. So did the people in the crowd. Mushu wasn't surprised.
Hey, you're a girl again, remember?
Along with the people in the square, Mulan watched Shang approach the Emperor.
Your Majesty, I present to you the sword of Shan Yu.
I know what this means to you, Captain Li. Your father would have been very proud.
As Shang handed the sword to the Emperor, a falcon swooped down and grabbed it. The falcon carried the sword to the palace rooftop and dropped it as it flew over a statue. Suddenly, the statue moved. It reached up and caught the sword, then raised the sword in triumph. It was Shan Yu Below, Shan-Yu's men slashed their way out of a parade dragon costume. They rushed up to the Emperor and grabbed him. Mulan watched Shang, Chen Po, Ling, and Yao try to break down the palace door. When she saw that the door wasn't budging, she hurried up to the men.
Hey, guys! I've got an idea.
The doubtful Shang stayed behind, but the other three ran after Mulan. She disguised them as women, knowing that the Huns would never imagine that women would fight back. Then, Shang decided to trust Mulan, and they all defeated the Hun guards. Just as Shan-Yu was about to kill the Emperor, Shang burst through the door. As he and Shan-Yu fought, Mulan threw a piece of cloth over a rope.
Chen Po, get the Emperor!
Using the rope as a slide, Chen Po helped the Emperor to safety. Shan-Yu tried to follow, but Mulan cut the rope. Shan-Yu turned on Shang.
You took away my victory!
No! I did.
Mulan pulled her hair back so she looked like a boy.
The soldier from the mountains.
Shan-Yu chased Mulan onto the palace roof.
It looks like you're out of ideas.
Not quite. Ready, Mushu?
Mushu had strapped a rocket to his back, and Cricky lit the fuse. As the rocket sped toward the roof, Mulan got hold of Shan-Yu's sword and drove it through the tip of his cloak, pinning him to the roof. She leaped out of the way just as the rocket smashed into Shan-Yu and carried him off, leaving his sword and cloak in place. Mushu and Cricky jumped off the rocket and clung to the sword, happy to have escaped. The rocket carrying Shan-Yu slammed into the fireworks tower, destroying him once and for all. Later, at the top of the palace steps, the Emperor thanked Mulan and tried to make her a member of his council.
With all due respect, Your Excellency, I think I've been away from home long enough.
The Emperor removed his pendant.
Then, take this, so your family will know what you have done for me.
He gave her Shan-Yu's sword.
And this, so the world will know what you have done for China.
Shang clumsily shook Mulan's hand.
You fight good.
Oh, thank you.
Mulan wished Shang had said or done more, but she hugged Chen Po, Ling, and Yao, then hurried home, where she presented the Emperor's gifts to her father.
The greatest gift and honor is having you for a daughter. I've missed you so.
Shang must have realized how special my granddaughter is, because he unexpectedly arrived at our home that very day. Mulan was delighted, and so were we. And by the way, Mushu earned his place as a family guardian again.
Guess who's back on pedestal 5? Call out for egg rolls!